know, we've done these seminars for a number of times, and we always do a seminar once a year at lunchtime because it tends to bring in a different group of people, and it's a bit too cold at night anyway. But as you know, we've tried to keep things very interesting and topical, because you see things in the newspapers, and you see their basic theory is the world's going to end, and things are going to end in a disaster, and it's going to be a crash. And of course, our job is to obviously lead you through all that and make sure that you're on the right track. But one of the things we do, and of course put the AFP behind us, is to provide you with a lot of background information on what's going on. Now, the great thing is, you know, where Shane works, he's got 300 people behind him working in AFP Capital day and night, 24/7, you know, making sure things go right. But we probably don't appreciate that. So one of the things you've got to appreciate is that there is a big institution behind us. There is a lot of research and knowledge there that goes into what happens. But Shane consistently every week literally sends out a report to us about whatever's topical. So when the Greece problem hit the news, we got a two-page briefing on that from Shane. And unfortunately, it was on holidays and had to work into the night or something to do it. But that's sort of backup that when you ring me, I'm just not making it up from newspapers. I've got something substantial behind me to actually talk to and get reference to. So when you've got a big organisation behind you, you can then rely on us to, you know what's going on. May not know the full picture, but we'll give you a balanced picture. That's the important thing. When you're looking at the newspapers, you'll get a distorted picture of what's going on. And they're only really, they're selling newspapers, we know that. But unfortunately, we have no other reference point when we're looking at a newspaper. So often we take what they say as gospel, but really we've got to give you a balanced view. So today I'm going to talk about Greece. It's going to be interesting because it's a case study in what can go wrong. And in economics, the important thing is to deliver wealth to the people, to a general population. But there's a number of features that make wealth grow. And if you don't have those features in the economy, you end up with a whole economy poorer. And this is going to be an example of Greece. So we're going to talk about Greece today. So I'll start off the presentation. So interesting thing about Greece is it's been in bankruptcy for many, many years. 50% of the time since 1829 it's been bankrupt. So it doesn't sound like a great place to lend money to, but as you'll see, it has been lent a lot of money over time. The issue with Greece is a big one because it is a lot bigger than the defaults we've had in the past. So you can see up here we've got reference to the Argentine bankruptcy or sovereign debt problem in 2001. We had the Russian bankruptcy in going back in 1998, much smaller levels of debt, and it was much easier for the world economy to absorb that. Now, technically, Greece is not bankrupt yet. It's only a technical term at this stage because they still are paying some people, but not everyone. It's the ECB is not being paid back, which is the European Community Bank. That's really probably the issue. And the IMF, but they are still trying to pay back their private debt. So the key thing is they've got around 180% of their GDP in national debt. Now, basically, once you go over 100%, governments usually have no capacity to pay the money back. That's basic the rule. 180%, they've just got no possibility of paying back the money, and that's because their economy has been contracting for the last 3 to 5 years. And the reason they've had to contract is because eventually they were forced to cut spending and the economy went in spiral. But the first thing is, how did it all start? Well, there's a guy called Andreas Papandreou who was basically the Gough Whitlam of Greece. He came in and brought in a great social welfare system, minimum wages, increased unemployment benefits, age pensions came in. He was basically the hero of Greece because he brought in this great, wonderful society which had not been there before. Brought in a national health system, started a national university system. So he's a great hero of Greece, but unfortunately he didn't raise taxes to pay for it. Sounds like a bit like the NDIS. They've promised the NDIS, but they never had any way of paying for it. So they didn't stop, they didn't have successive governments who stopped this or cut back spending or increase taxes. So the debt just kept going up. And this started in the 1980s, so there's a long period of time where the debt's been rising. But then in 2001, the magic point in came with joining the community as a European community. The European community was designed to bring all Europeans together to avoid any future wars, to bring a national approach to the whole European community. And Chris, of course, is a great chain, let's get on that. The key thing there was that they had to submit to an audit before they got in there, but they didn't really tell all the truth. They had sold off their airlines at the time, sorry, their airports to private sector through a company called Goldman Sachs, and they didn't tell them there was $10 billion less in the pot that was actually there. We don't know, there might be a lot more to it than that, but that was the only thing I heard about. But basically, they got in on false pretenses. But once they were in, nobody really knew that they were in there for false pretenses until about 2007 when their debt really went through the roof. But the key thing in there is that they had an A-minus credit rating. Now, they really weren't probably typically well, they should have really had an A-minus credit rating, but because they're part of the European community, they got this A-minus credit rating, which allowed them to borrow a lot more money than they had before. And by 2009, the deficit was growing very steadily, and in 1 year, their deficit went up 15%, just in 1 year, 15% GDP. That's just government debt. That's forgetting any other debt, like your housing debt, your corporate debt. So they really were going out of control. And to give you the example, in 2009, they were estimating a 3.7% GDP debt within 18 months, or less than up to 15%. So there's some really strange things going on there in economic terms. But when you work it out, the Greek government was spending $4, and every $1 of that was being borrowed. So, you know, they're on a road to nowhere. They couldn't be sustained. So the European community said you're going to have to cut back your spending. That then probably created a recession, and the result was a rise in unemployment and a severe economic recession. So because the government was such a big part of Greek society, Greek economy, they were really pulling out the rope from underneath the economy. There was a story that there was a dam they built 20 or 30 years ago in Greece. They were still paying the contractors to turn up every day. They built the dam 20 years ago or something like that. There's some incredible stories about bad management, incompetence, corruption, nepotism. There's a story that it takes about three times the cost to build 1 kilometre of road in Greece than it does in Germany. The Germans pay great wages, they get 6 weeks holiday a year, they work 37 hours. How can it be three times? Well, it gets eaten up in bad management, nepotism, corruption, bad education standards. They're not a very highly educated country by European standards. The level of education is quite low. So these things all erode your competitiveness as a country to compete. So you can only sit in the sun and drink coffee for so long. So they then had a bailout package from the European community, because the European community does want to keep everyone on board and keep, and this is what's driving Angela Merkel. Her idea is that we should try and keep Greece in the European community if we can, but the Greeks have got to help themselves a bit. But the problem is that their economy is now 28% less than it was, so they're a third less wealthy than they were. Age pensions being cut, public service wages being cut, and that runs through the whole economy. Then people who service those people, the shopkeepers can't charge as much on their wages, on their prices. Then the shopkeeper says, well, we've got to cut wages for the employees. And that's what's happening. A lot of wages have been cut in Greece. Unemployment's now 25% of the population, so 1 in 4. And that's very much like what happened in the Great Depression. In Australia, we had up to 31% unemployment. That was people who had no job. roughly another third had part-time jobs in the Great Depression Australia, and a third, the only last third, had full-time jobs. Well, it's probably what's happening in Greece. Probably a lot of people are part-time, probably just getting bits and pieces of work when they can. Unemployment for the youth is 50% or more. Now that's a tragedy. It's in young people who tend to get worse out of this because they're trying to get into the workforce, they don't have the skills, there's plenty of other people with skills, they can't get entry into the workforce. So what's happened? The Greece debt has gone through the roof, so that's not a big revelation, so around 180% of GDP. You've got now an income that's declining in Greece, whereas the rest of Europe has their income going up as average income. So roughly what they're saying here is back in 2008, the average Greek was getting about 10,000 euros a year, which is about $15,000 a year, and now it's only about 18. So they've dropped to probably about 20% of their average incomes. Unemployment obviously has gone through the roof and much higher than the EU average, and that's not good for the young people of the country, because basically they say, well, we'll move on to somewhere else, go to Germany or somewhere else to live. Population and poverty, obviously nearly 40% looking to live below the poverty line there, and that's effectively means is people go through rubbish bins to keep themselves going and that sort of stuff. Unemployed, 80% of the unemployed are long-term unemployed, that is they just haven't had a job for more than 12 months, and that's when you get this chronic despair coming through the community. So you can see the real collapse here when you compare to other countries, that places like Ireland comparatively had a similar sort of dramatic situation where all their banks in Ireland went bankrupt and they had to get bailed out by the government. Key thing is Ireland's taken its medicine, they cut back public service wages, cut back government spending, and now they're starting to see they're coming out of recession. So, you know, you can go to these things, and if you have the right policies, you can get out of them. Unfortunately, Greece has taken some of the wrong policies, not really to approach the whole thing in a very structured way. They haven't had good government, haven't really approached their problems, and they're still contracting until roughly recently. They're expecting to get better, but they're contracting their economy here, year after year after year. So there's just no sight or potentially hope in sight, but we just don't know if that's going to happen. But other countries like Spain, similar problems, a large amount of debt because of the government, of the banking system, starting to recover their economy. Italy's not doing so well. Another issue, probably they need to address a lot more of their issues, but they've got problems with their government. France is doing okay, and Germany's leading the pack. But it just shows that every country is dealing with these issues in a different way. So, major reason why outside loans might improve the Greek economy is that the various governments have not deregulated the employment market. That's one thing, they've got very highly regulated employment markets. Productivity hasn't improved as a result, and therefore you're not getting value from your employees. Even though the wages have been cut, it's not being transferred into people employing new staff because there's very strict regulations on. And this is all through Europe as well, on getting rid of people. So if you worry that things are going to get worse next year, you're not going to put people on this year, especially if you can't sack them. That's a problem. The industrial base of Greece is very narrow. It's really agriculture and tourism. Tourism is really about three to four months of the year when it's warm in Europe in the summer, and the rest of the year there's not much going on. But the key thing is their agricultural base competes against all the other southern European countries. So you've got Spain who produce olives, you've got Italy who produces olives, and they produce olives. So what's the difference between a Greek olive and an Italian olive? Well, they call them calamari. There's not much, you can't differentiate one olive from another. You can't get what we call a quality improvement in what we're selling. So in agriculture, we call it, you're a price taker. You put your product to the market. If there's an oversupply, you get a more poor price. If there's an undersupply, you get a higher price, and you just take what you can. And Greece is in that situation. They can't devalue their currency, and this is the big problem, to compensate for it. But coming back to Australia, I'm just thinking about Australia, you know, we're not immune from this problem, that we've run up a lot of government debt. Since 2011, we've actually run up about 30% increase in our government debt. Now, from a very low base, mind you, but we've got to bear in mind that, if you keep doing that, you're getting the same sort of problems. Greece is still running up their debt, so they're in the middle of the pack there. But there's a lot of other countries that run up debt too. But what we're really saying is you've got to be careful we don't get the same problems. So net foreign debt in Greece is increasing, so you can see all through this period here, it's been increasing, and potentially stabilising, but maybe if things get better, they might start paying the debt back. But you know, when you get 180% GDP debt, you're really in problems. Other countries got the same problem. You can see Ireland had a big rise in their debt, and then hopefully it'll get out through the next few years. Spain the same. And Germany, their debt's declining because they're actually in positive territory up there. So what happens now? Key things is that they're still on the edge of defaulting. You know, it's not disappeared just because it made improvement, because the IMF has still got to agree to this. I'm not sure if that's still come through yet. Shane, you know if they've agreed to the IMF?
So far they haven't.
They haven't yet. It's still in process yet. So it could still erupt in the next few weeks that the IMF, and the IMF is like anyway, you're not going to lend to someone who's bankrupt, basically. You're not going to send good money off the bag. So they've got to analyse whether they lend money to Greece. That's part of the package. The ECB's got the same issues. They're actually giving short-term aid in the form of currency to the banks to keep the banks in euros. But they're not going to keep doing that if they never see that again. So what happens if they do go back? Let's say they have to go to the drachma, which is their old currency. The first positive, though, is that you get a repayment holiday, who's not paying up your debts. And that can mean that your government spending can actually go in other areas rather than paying back debt. And that's a positive for the economy in the initial phases. You don't lose that money out of the economy, therefore it's done a research right back in the economy, which is a good thing. But you then have a recession because Greece has been importing capital all this time to keep it going. You still have to substitute that in some other ways. But the key thing here that if they do go to the drachma, their currency will collapse and they'll be able to export a lot more than they have. They're being constrained at this stage because they're in the euro. And in the past, Greece, Italy and Spain have always used their currency as a mechanism to get out of these problems. You collapse the currency, it makes exporters competitive, makes imports very expensive, and then you get out of the problems over that way. And it never then had to be a government issue of control of the economy. And they avoided some of their bigger issues of deregulating the economy, making the economy work better by using the currency. So if you do have a currency that crashes, you get less imports, more exports, and that starts to get the economy going. And this is just a guy's sort of projection about if they did start to make labour market reforms, which is the lower line, that they improved their GDP by 2-4%. If they started other market reforms like deregulating their shopping hours and all sorts of things like that, you can get a lot bigger lift in your economy. And that's really what it's about. And that's the problem with governments, of course, is that any change is always resistant. And then our government has no strategy to that. The only thing that if you do stop paying back your debts, there's a net leak, you're not getting an effectively net import into the economy, so that does restrict the economy a bit because they're actually importing money from overseas. Government spending may have to fall again, but depending on how they get their tax collections going. In Greece, they're notorious for evading tax, so if they could just let the tax that they should, that would have been out of the problems, but they don't have a culture of very strong tax collection. The only long-term effect, of course, is that you have less spending in government, and government spend money on schools and hospitals and roads, and that deteriorates your whole economic structure, which means you're less competitive again because you've got poor roads, you've got people are not as well educated, but people with less health. All that then adds into a lower economic output. And the young and the able leave the country, and that's where you lose your capital wealth. the people who are most able to help you get out of the problem are leaving, and that's what's happening in Greece at present moment. They just go to Germany, get a good job, and get into the system there, because they can. There's no borders now in Europe. You walk over the border and start in a new country. So they're losing potentially over their most productive people. The banks, again, going to be the bigger issue. If people don't have confidence in banks because they couldn't get money out of the ATMs the other day, they're going to say, well, we're not going to put any money into a bank anymore. And they've been doing that for a couple of years now. So the only way that banks can operate is getting money from the ECB, and there's maybe a time limit on that. But the big longer-term problem is if banks can't get any money, and they can't lend any money, and lending money is where you create wealth, because businesses open up new shops, people buy new houses, they buy new cars. If you can't get it from the bank, where do you go? You just don't look at it all. In Greece, in the last 5 years, new car sales have dropped 80%. So 80% you're not getting new cars coming in. So you think that's 80% of the new car market that people don't have a job. If you don't need 80% of sales, you only have 20% sales. That reverberates all through the economy. So banks being the crucial part of any economy, if you start to lose the confidence in the banking system, then the whole economy starts to wind down. You're just using cash, using barter. That's not going to be a good system to be. So the European Bank has given the emergency money at this stage. Don't know how long that's going to continue. Eventually the banks are going to fix the bank problem. So I think it might be. This third risk factor is still up in the air, and it really depends on the IMF and ECB. But the Greece has got the problem that they've got left with government who doesn't really believe in privatisation, and they've agreed to a major privatisation of their economy of $50 billion. You know, ports, railways, everything literally was on the block, and they don't like it. And they're internally within their own party, they're rebelling against it. So whether the Greeks actually follow through with all that privatisation is another issue. So these are just using an idea there, just some of the things that are going to be played over the next couple of months. So we're at the 6th of July today. But the 7th of July, there was supposed to be a repayment to the ECB of $3.5 billion. I'm not sure that went through. Oh, that's the 7th of August, sorry. This is to the Treasury bills. They're private sector, mainly private sector repayments. I'm not sure they're repaying those, so I think they were trying to pay those. But the ECB's got, on the 20th of August, they've got $3.5 billion to come up there. And you can see there's just every couple of weeks they've got major repayments. Now, whether they fork via those, I don't know. And it's a big task, therefore. So how did they get in that economic mess? Well, in the past they used to use the currency to get out of their messes, and they just don't have the currency to do that. They're tied in the euro. And they never really concentrated on improving productivity like a lot of other countries. And that's what we've got in Australia. We've got still got a lot of work to do in increasing productivity, but unfortunately with the Hunt Senate, the government's really hamstrung doing a lot of things because people don't want change. And that's what we've really got to learn about in Australia, is it needs to improve productivity. It's essential that we do that to enjoy a great lifestyle. And bear in mind, you know, most of our people here today are in retirement. We're living off our wealth. But we need that wealth to create that retirement. If we don't have the people behind us in our employment creating the wealth, well, we won't have a good retirement. That's basically what's going to happen. So in Greece, they borrowed their way into a drama, but they didn't spend it in the right ways. They increased their social welfare, but they really didn't put a lot of work into making their economy work better. So economic reform is really so important in any government's election mandate, but of course if you get it blocked by the Senate, they can't do much. But at this stage, you know, the government's just doing lots of reviews in Australia and saying, well, we're doing nothing until the next election. So everyone's hanging on that there's a clear result of the next election before they can do anything, which is a bit of a shame because time marches on. So really, what we should be aware of in Australia is that we should be rewarding governments who've got strong reform agendas, like the Hawke-Keating government. They came in with a very strong agenda of change. They made that change happen by getting rid of the unions, which was a key part of our textiles, clothing, footwear industries, were moved away from our car industries. This government has moved away from the car industry, and so we can move our economy to more productive sectors. Now, some people say, oh, you know, we should keep the car industry. But at the end of the day, how many people driving Australian cars? Very few. So you do have an idea. So the thing is, a lot of people say it's a great thing to have a car industry, but they don't buy Australian cars. So are we subsidising Australian makers and produce cars that people don't want to buy? That's lying. So I know it's nice to have a car industry, but there's other ways you can get people employed. There's tourism, there's other rural manufacturing sectors that you can get people employed in, where they're actually paid better, and that's the other thing, they're paid better in other industries. So we really should think about this, the Greek story, as an analogy that could happen to Australia, maybe, if you don't have the right government, the right reforms, and the right processes. They certainly had a lot of problems in Greece with their culture, and it's a culture there's been a very lax culture there to approach some things, but their government didn't help, and the debts didn't help, and eventually it's all broken like stuff. So at the end of the day, we should learn from these sort of things, that other countries can go wrong, but we can learn from them. So that's pretty much my presentation. The main thing is that this is an example of just how quickly things can change. 2014, our purchasing power was around 50 in the world. It's now 9th, and potentially this year could drop to 16th. Now, that reflects really the exchange rates, because our exchange rates dropped around 30% plus against the US dollar. But that just really shows that you can't just rely on being top dollar forever. You've got to keep moving your economy on and doing structural reform, because otherwise we won't have the purchasing power in the future to keep our economy going. So that's my presentation. And now I'm going to introduce Shane, who's come here all the way from Sydney. Just give a bit of an intro about Shane. You've probably seen him on TV, and he's one of the probably five economists that we see in Australia on the TV and commenting on various things. Shane is our official person for contact with the media on that point of view. He heads the investment or group called AMP Capital, which has got $16 billion under management. He went to Macquarie University and finished in 1991 his PhD. After a few years there, I think part time, I think it's Shane.
Yeah.
So, appointed chief economist in 1994, so coming up over 20 years now, so got a few long service lead up there. as I said, he's been the spokesman for AMP for some years now. So, I'll put Shane to you today, and he's going to tell you a story about the world economy.
Okay, thanks Russell. It's a pleasure to be here today. I was a bit fearful in Sydney yesterday. It was 10 degrees at lunchtime. I think the only time I'd ever in the middle of the day gone out with an overcoat. So, I was fearful that I'd come to Melbourne to Canberra rather than be freezing. Melbourne's always cold, but Canberra is freezing. But it's turned out it was a good day to come to Canberra. Hard to disagree with anything much Russell said, particularly in relation to Greece. I had a holiday about 5-6 weeks ago for 2 weeks. Every single weekend of that holiday, we were all hanging on what was going to happen in Greece. The first weekend was Tsipras announcing a referendum on the package. The second weekend was the referendum itself, where they rejected the package. By the third weekend, it was all about whether Greece would finally sign up to something, which was actually more aggressive than the package they rejected in the first place. So you kind of wonder what they've actually gained by all the noise, but it was a noisy time to go on holiday. And in the midst of all that, we had the fall of the Chinese share market certainly as well, which has made me think, given the experience I've had with holidays over the years, maybe I shouldn't go on them. I think back to 2010, I actually had a holiday in Greece, took my family there, and of course that was the early phase of the Greek Eurozone crisis. And the market was plunging at the time. In the middle of 2010, you may not recall, our share market fell about 15%. One thing I did learn from Greece, was that I'd never seen so many people sitting around on the side of the road, usually with rickety chairs, little tables, playing backgammon, smoking. Never seen so many smokers drinking ouzo, whatever it is they drink. And I kind of thought to myself, well, this could be a sort of an interesting place in the next few years. In subsequent times, you know, I've been to the US, been to France, other parts of Europe, and you kind of think these places are radically different to what I saw in Greece there. So it kind of fits in with what Russell was saying. I mean, it is literally a country that's gone off the rails for a whole bunch of reasons. I'll try and talk a bit more broadly, given the fantastic production Russell's done regarding Greece, and I'll also cover some of the other parts of the world. Just a quick review here. I should point out, as always, people like me, economists, is on? Is he down the back? This is on yellow. Yeah. As always, I've shown up with too many slides. I think I had something like 50 or 60 when I passed to my colleague Adam to come down here yesterday. Good news is I won't go through them all. Why do I have so many slides? I guess, you know, they're like a prop. I was once presenting to the Australian Independent Retirees Association in Renmark in South Australia, and I observed that I would feel naked if I didn't have all these slides. And this elderly lady at the front said, well, that would be all right, wouldn't it? Anyway, this slide shows the returns from a bunch of asset classes. One of these, I think, is a pointer. Australian shares, international shares, Aussie bonds, global bonds, listed property, what we call REITs, real estate investment trust these days, global listed property, directly held commercial property, that's portfolio, offices, industrial property, and so on, and cash. And the blue bars relate to returns from the last financial year, the green bars are from the 2013-14 financial year. And the point about it is the returns have been pretty good over the last few years. It's hard to complain if you look at the average returns. Several lessons from that, though. One is, you've got to turn down the noise. Think about the last few years, lots of noise in there. Fiscal cliff in America, the US government shut down, the Cyprus, yeah, Greece blowing up again, Ukraine last year, Ebola, there's always something. And the media has a job in life. It's not necessarily to inform us, it's actually to make profits for whoever owns the media outlet. And you make maximum profits by getting maximum readers or viewers. And how do you do that? You put more bad news stories in there. The good news stories, as they say, bad news sells. So that's why, you know, if the Aussie share market falls 2%, you see the headline, Greece wipes $30 billion out of the Australian share market. If the Aussie share market rises 2%, you won't see that headline. It's the same percentage moves, same $1 billion amount, it's just in the other direction, but it won't make the headline. So bad news does sell, and that's whether you look at a quality newspaper like the Financial Review or a lower end Daily Telegraph or whatever it is. And I'm not being judgmental, that I do actually read the Daily Telegraph. It's my Sunday reading Sunday Telegraph. So you've got to be very selective, and that's what Russell's done. He's gone through the Financial Review, we've got the value parts out there where you can see them, you know, the odd chart here and there. So there is value there, but you've got to turn down all the excitement. Investing is really like watching paint dry or grass grow. So you turn down that noise, try to focus on the core issues. Another big message the last week is inflation is still MIA. Anyone know what MIA stands for? Missing in action, good, because you remember Chuck Norris from back in the 80s in that film he made. What people don't seem to get that when I put that up, say, what the hell is MIA? But it's missing in action, and we still don't have inflation in Houston. When I grew up in the 60s, it was steadily rising, rate of inflation. In the 70s, it went into hyperdrive, very high inflation, worries about hyperinflation. And then, of course, it was also very high in the early years of my career in the 1980s. These days, though, a bigger concern is deflation, and Japan has experienced that. So I know the price of healthcare, the price of education, and some other necessities have gone up, like my electricity bill. Well, actually, last year it went down, prior to that going up. But there's lots of other things, like the price of these things and the things you get on it, going down in price.
Now, when I was a kid back in 1975, colour TV was produced. How big was our colour TV set? Well, it was about this big. How big is the TV set that my kids use mostly now? Well, it's about this big and flat screen. How big is our family TV? Well, it's huge. And those things in real prices, adjusted for today's pricing, are far cheaper than they were when my parents bought their first colour TV back in 1975. So that's an example. Price deflation, prices coming down. That's meant interest rates stay very low. Bond yields stay very low. So that's why you've got the situation of such low interest rates on bank term deposits, because there's not a lot of inflation out there. Finally, capital messages, asset allocation is very important. You know, if you just had cash last year, you would have got a low return. Whereas you would have done much better in shares. Other times it's the other way around. But also diversification is very important. Don't just have all of your assets in one basket, like don't have it all in Australia. You might have wanted to have some overseas. The last few years, global shares, global investments have actually been a somewhat better bet than Australian shares. It always moves around, but just don't have all of your eggs in one basket. So, how do I see things? Well, this is a big one. This is the level of interest rate. So the Reserve Bank sets the green line there, that's the official cash rate. Currently 2%, the lowest it's ever been. The blue line is the average 3-year term deposit rate, and the red line is the average bank 1-year term deposit rate. They are the lowest since before Marshall Brady was born. I'm sure you don't realise that Marshall was played by, you might realise this, Maureen McCormack, and she was born, I think, in 1955. She's actually a little bit older than me. And that was long before she started in the Brady Bunch, which was 1969. Anyway, you've got to go back to the early 1950s to get interest rates as low as this. And it's the same for the mortgage rate. My parents got married in 1956, and they soon after that, the mortgage, their interest rate, is probably comparable to some of the rates you're seeing today. That's how far you've got to go back to get something comparable. Very low interest rates. My mother recently saw me on Channel 7, and the Reserve Bank cut interest rates. And she immediately phoned me up. I never tell her in advance if I'm going to be on the TV because I get nervous. I'm thinking someone might watch me. But I think there's no one out there except that little black eye looking at you. Anyway, she phones up and says, how come you had a smile on your face when you said that interest rates might go lower? Don't you realise it upsets people like me? And I'm thinking, my mortgage, of course, so it makes me happy. But she still doesn't have a smile on her face. Regarding that, she would rather have higher interest rates, even though she's got investments elsewhere. She does have some money in cash, and she's not getting a great return there. And I think we all know the story. The term deposit rates have come down from, get a deal, 5 years ago, about 8% at Westpac for 5 years. You're now coming off that deal, you're down to around 2.5%. So I guess the key point is, you've got to think about going somewhere else. If you're just relying on term deposits, maybe you want to go somewhere else. And then you've got to think about, well, what's most important to you? Capital stability, preserving the value of your investment, or is getting a decent yield and a decent stable yield more important to you? Because you can actually get a better income flow or yield flow from other avenues of investment. So that's something I think we all need to think about in this environment. So, how do I see the world? I think it's sort of okay. I know the Greek stuff is very scary. I know China is very scary. It scares me at times. Now, this affects us all, not just everybody else, except Russell and I. It affects all of us. We're all affected by this, and it does make us scared about the future. But I think it's always worth trying to put things in perspective. Sit down, calmly think about it. Well, how many people live in Greece? How big a portion of the world economy is it? It's only 0.25% of total world economic activity. Is it really going to bring down everything else? Probably not. And when you look around the world, the global economy is still growing. It's not as strong as it used to be, but it is still growing. In some ways, having these little events like Greece, like China, there's little shocks every so often. Keep a lid on global growth. You don't want growth to be too strong. If it gets too strong, what do we worry about? We worry about inflation and higher interest rates. So you need a balance. And I think